Welcome back. Today is the second day of the Open Source Data Center Conference. Hopefully you slept well. And the other guys that aren't here, maybe not that well. I assume there is a reason for that, but we don't have to talk about that. We want to listen to the talk from Henrik Schöttler about data protection, software licenses, and other legal issues in the cloud. Yeah, enjoy it.
Thank you, first of all, for the opportunity to speak here today. My name is Henrik Schöttler. As already announced, I'm a lawyer in Munich, a qualified lawyer for IT law. I've worked as a programmer as well for quite some time, but that's been, I think, to the scale in the IT business ages ago, so late 90s, when Web 2.0 was still something nobody knew what it would look like. This is what I'm going to talk about in the next hour. If there are any questions during my presentation, just ask. If I'm speaking too slow, if I'm speaking too speedy, just let me know. And yeah, I hope that we may have some discussions. Data protection, software licenses, and what I call other issues are the main topics. Data protection, software licenses, of course. So perhaps a quick brief overview on data protection issues from a historical point of view. What we are dealing here in Germany with is a law which has been, which came into force in 1977. The Federal Data Protection Act. And it has not been amended and changed too much since that day. So, whom of you did already work with computers in 1977? None. Okay. But perhaps you know from the German Museum for Technik and from pictures and from the internet that in these ages computers were a bit bigger than today, and data processing was a bit more complicated than today. So if you set up a database, this setup of a database was quite some work. That's why the Federal Data Protection Act, for instance, has some stipulations obliging you to notify the supervisory authority when setting up a database. Nowadays, you create a new folder, copy some items into this folder, and you have a new database. Just imagine the same obligations applying for two completely different processes. So we have a fairly outdated law. We have to deal with it somehow, which is not very easy, but somehow we get along. It doesn't have anything to do with modern technology. It doesn't have anything to do with what we are doing today. So the Federal Constitutional Court fills the gaps, which means from time to time we have some new jurisdiction on certain specific issues among data protection, but that's just one spot or one small issue. It's not the big thing, so we don't have a law where we could say this is up to date, this is fitting for the needs and for the requirements that we have today. In addition, this law is not very clear, so we have open terms and open clauses, which makes it flexible on the one side, but on the other hand, also makes it quite difficult to work with it. It's not very clear how you should react on certain issues, how you should be compliant with the law. You're mainly dependent from the data protection supervisory authorities. In Germany, these authorities have a very strong position, which means these authorities have certain opinions. These opinions are not confirmed by courts. These opinions are not confirmed, well, of course, confirmed by legal professionals to some extent, but still it's just an opinion, but you have to deal with it. And you're very well advised if you take a look at the opinions of these supervisory authorities, because otherwise you simply, have to deal with conflicts. You may be confronted by these authorities with their point of view. Meaning, you better take a look at the FAQ page of the Bundesdatenschutzbeauftragter, for instance. Some more legal sources, just as an overview, we have the European Data Protection Directive, we have a not directive concerning processing of personal data with respect to the telecommunication sector. We have an e-commerce directive, which also contains some regulations on data protection law. And, well, another directive on privacy and electronic communications. We just are dealing with a draft on a new harmonized EU law with respect to data protection. So the EU is about to issue a another directive which will be binding for all the member states. And this may make in the, well, further future, dealing with data protection issues among the European Union much more easier. Because today we have different laws in every single country, from very strict to, as in Germany for instance, to almost no data protection in fact existing. And this may be solved in the future so that we have one single legal framework among the EU, and this will probably make data transfers easier. However, of course, we have now to struggle with the wording of the draft, with the possible outcome of the legislative process, and of course we have to see how the European Court of Justice, what this court says to the single issues and single clauses of this directive. But that's still the future, so up to date we have the national legislation and jurisdiction, and we still have to deal with it. Now some principles on data protection before we go to the merits of special requirements of cloud computing. Data protection law is somehow odd for the legals as well as for the non-legals, because it's not too close to what we know as civil law, what we know as public law. It's got some certain restrictions, it's got certain requirements that are deviating from normal or legal bodies that we have to deal with and that we have to understand before we can get deeper into the details of cloud computing. Personal data is the main term which defines the applicability of the data protection law. So in Germany, the data protection law does only concern personal data. The moment we don't have any personal data, we don't have to deal with data protection law. However, personal data is defined very wide. It's defined in Section 3 of the Federal Data Protection Act. It means information concerning the personal and material circumstances of an identified or identifiable individual. This is then defined as the data subject, this individual, which is what is very important is this term, identifiable. So personal data is not only data that you can easily combine with a certain person, meaning name of a person, age, whatever kind of social security numbers, but also certain data that is not yet connected to a person, but it is connectable. So here we have email address, account details as an example. The supervisory authorities also count Google Street View data, meaning the front view of your house, as personal data. Why? Because you can connect this data to a certain address, and you can connect this address to the owner of a house or to the people living in this house. And this is enough in order to speak of personal data according to the supervisory authorities. IP addresses, next big issue, which is I think now resolved, but it's been discussed among legal experts for quite some while, is the IP address of personal data. So what do you think? I mean, got the solution on the slides, but still, we had lots of discussions in the past. Outcome is now that the static IP address is concerned to personal data, as the static IP address does not change, and as it can be easily combined with a certain computer and thus with a certain person working on this computer. Dynamic IP address has been discussed because dynamic IP addresses, as you all know, are changing with every new login procedure, or even if you get a flat rate after 24 hours, usually the connection is disconnected and then you may get a new IP address. There the supervisory authority said, if a link to a person is easily possible, so if you are the telco provider, if you are the internet provider, then for you the IP address has to be treated as personal data. If this link is not possible, then it can be regarded as, well, data but not personal data. In doubt, you have to treat it as personal data, and this is common sense among the legal professionals. Every IP address currently has to be dealt as personal data. Meaning, if you have a log file, for instance, and if this log file stores the IP addresses, you're very well advised if you hide the last byte, or if you hash the value, if you want to have some server statistics. But simply to store it as plain text and full text may be an issue from data protection law point of view. So, processing of personal data. What does processing mean? The Federal Data Protection Act is mainly dependent on processing of personal data. Basic principle, typical for Germany, everything which is not explicitly permitted is not allowed. So, in every case where you deal with personal data, you need an explicit permit from a legal point of view, to deal with this personal data. If you don't have such a permit, it's not allowed. Processing is again defined in a very broad way as the personal data. Storage, modification, transfer, deletion, any kind of treatment with data is regarded as processing. So in the end, the moment you have to deal with personal data in whatever way, you're subject to the Federal Data Protection Act. And this makes it, from a practical point of view, very difficult because the Federal Data Protection Act has only certain basic principles and certain basic rules regarding the allowance, the permit to deal with personal data. If you don't can rely on such a rule, then it's not permitted. So what justifications do you have? In which cases are you allowed to deal with personal data? This is a list of the justifications contained in the Federal Data Protection Act. There may be some more justifications in special laws for special cases. In general, this is the list that you can rely on when you want to justify your personal treatment or your treatment you're handling with personal data. One justification which has been, I think, stressed a bit too much in the past is the consent of the data subject, meaning the person to whom this data belongs. The moment this person consents to the treatment and the processing of the personal data, you're fine from a data protection law point of view. Consent means, first of all, it must be on an informed and voluntary basis. That's how it is defined in the Data Protection Act. Informed basis means the person which is declaring his or her consent has to know what it's all about, plainly said. So it has to know, he or she has to know, how will the data be treated, who will have access to the data, what will happen actually in fact. And this is not too easy, so we have lots of jurisdictions, for instance, for marketing opt-ins, where the court said this is not on an informed basis. Simply because, for instance, you said, well, I may receive emails from my marketing partners and emails from other third-party providers for marketing purposes. And there the courts say, frequently, this is simply too broad. If you declare your opt-in, if you give your opt-in, you don't know who will send you marketing emails. So it has to be enlisted. You have to have an exhaustive list which states these 3, 10, 15, 200 persons or legal entities will provide, will send me marketing, for instance. So informed basis is not too easy, especially if it's a more complicated business model. Same issue is currently visible with regard to Facebook. In Schleswig-Holstein, the data protection authority said what Facebook is doing with respect to the social plugins, we'll come to that later, is not compliant with German data protection, simply because no one knows what Facebook does with the data, and it's not explained on their website, it's not explained on privacy policy. Facebook then extended their privacy policy and almost wrote a little book about what Facebook does with the personal data. Still, that's the last information I have, the supervisory authority is of the opinion that this is not sufficient. So informed basis, not very easy. Voluntary basis, not very easy as well with respect to certain special situations. For instance, employees. There the courts say, well, if your employer gives you something to sign, what will you do? You will sign it. You won't say, hey, I won't give my consent. So we have a new draft on data protection law with respect to employees. And there in the draft it said, such consent is never on a voluntary basis. So if you're dealing with a consent with respect to your employees, you won't be able to do so in the future if this draft becomes law. Simply because a consent declaration in an employee relationship is never voluntary. Next issue, which is very well forgotten, the consent is revocable. You can at any time say, well, that's enough, I withdraw my consent. And so you have to think about, well, what will you do then? If you say the transfer, for instance, to non-European country, we'll come to that later as well, is only possible based on consent, and this consent is revoked, you have to have a backup. If you're obliged to provide certain services for your customers, and these customers says, well, no consent anymore, then you will have to provide the services from the EU, from the European Union, or from Germany. So the revocability is also an issue you have to keep in mind, and you have to set up processes for. Of course, this does also apply for marketing emails, for instance. If your clients say, well, I don't want to receive marketing emails, you all know it, this little unsubscribe link in the email that you get every time. Somehow it has to be foreseen, it has to be contained in the process that you can revoke the consent, and that from a technical point of view, you also can implement this revocation. So much for consent as a justification. Then you have the purpose of a contract, which may justify a certain processing of personal data. This can be, for instance, an agreement on certain cloud computing services. However, purpose of a contract with a concerned person. This means if your customer has, again, own customers, if your customer is dealing with third-party personal data of customers, of customers, friends, customers, customers, whoever, the specific data subject has to have a contract, and it has to serve this this purpose of the contract with a specific data subject. So if you think about it, in many cases you just have a contract with your with the first chain, with the first piece in the chain, but you don't, of course, you don't have contracts with every single data subject that may get along and that may be involved in this in the personal data. So this is also, well, it's working sometimes, but not always. Next justification, overriding interests. The data protection law says there are two interests, one of you in processing the data and one of the data subject in the data not being processed or the data not being processed that way. And if you can prove that your interests are to be estimated higher than the interests of the data subject, then you may, well, process the data as you intend to do. However, this is some kind of very vague clause. When are interests overriding, when are they not overriding? This is not precisely defined by law and not precisely defined by the supervisory authorities as well. So it may help, but don't rely 100% of it, because it's in practice it very often happens that the supervisory authority says, well, I don't follow you, I don't see your interest overweighing, so you're not allowed to process the data, at least on this basis here. Then you have some other special regulations for employees and company agreements, but I won't go into detail here. So now, some special requirements for cloud computing. In cloud computing, we mainly look at this relationship. You have the cloud user, he's processing the data in the cloud, and then you have the cloud provider. And somehow this cloud user, who is dealing with data anyway, but now wants to do it in a cloud and not in his own or on his own computers anymore, this cloud user has to justify, from a data protection law point of view, the processing of personal data. This cloud user again has relationships to his customers or employees. So there you have a employment contract, you have a customer agreement, whatever this agreement may look like, and you have a service contract with a cloud provider. And here, this contract has to contain certain regulations, and this contract, of course, has to comply with German data protection law. What do the supervisory authorities say to cloud computing and data protection? First of all, say the user, the cloud user, is the responsible entity. So if you are using cloud services, it doesn't help if you say, well, I'm not processing the data anyway, I just gave it to Amazon in the cloud and Amazon is processing the data somehow. I don't know how, but I'm not responsible, it's their job. That doesn't help from a law, from a legal point of view. So you are still responsible, which means you have to set up the legal framework that enables you to do this cloud computing, and you may even have to set up a certain framework in order to control your cloud computing provider. So if you collect the data for yourself or process it, then you are the responsible entity. And if you do this with other entities together, then if you have control over the processing of data, you are the responsible entity. So it's all about the control, it's all about who does in fact decide what to do with the data and what not to do with the data. One big result from that conclusion from that is that you have to ensure that you are able to that you are able to comply with data protection law and not the cloud computing provider, and you are responsible for checking that you comply with data protection law and that the provider does so as well. So it, again, it doesn't help if you say, well, provider said everything's fine, but I didn't check it. You have to do so, you have to check it, and you are responsible from a data protection law point of view. Question?
I have a question on what does mean you are responsible. Is it the company, or is it which person is it in the company?
First of all, yes. First of all, it is the company. So with respect to liability against customers, against third-party concerned persons, as we say, it's the company. But then again, within the company, there may be a responsibility, for instance, for the management level, that the management level has to set up certain compliance rules, has to set up certain policies in order to ensure that within the company, again, the standard is met and the compliance is provided for. So it may be an issue up to the responsible persons for the data protection or for the data processing that they have to ensure compliance with law. So we do know some first case law with respect to liability of single persons where it was not provided that in any way compliance was given. There was no compliance regulation set up, and then there were severe infringements of legal requirements where the courts then said that a person is personally liable. But mainly, of course, with respect to the users, it's the company who's liable. Okay. Applicability of German data protection laws, one big question. As very often we hear arguments like, well, I'm not processing the data in Germany anyway, or not even I am processing the data, but still it's my cloud provider and he has its service outside of the US. So now we want to take a look, what about the applicability of German data protection law as well, as such. One remark, I said it in the beginning, if you're not from Germany and if you're not dealing with German data protection law, a good thing is, once you comply with German law, you pretty much comply with the laws, at least within Europe, because German data protection laws, as I said, one of the strictest in the world. And even with the implementation of the new EU directive, it's not very likely that it will become worse as it is now. So, section one of the Federal Data Protection Act says that German data protection law applies when a non-European cloud provider collects, uses, or processes data in Germany. That's not written literally in the section, but you can derive it from that. So once you have a non-European context, then with respect to processing of data in Germany, the German data protection law is applicable. The moment we have to deal with an EU member state provider, then it's much easier because then the respective law of the member states apply. So if you have a web, if you have a host provider in Ireland, for instance, if you have a host provider in France, wherever, then the respective data protection law of these countries do apply, and not the German data protection law. And the last bullet point, of course, is one big issue from a practical point of view. If you're subject to German data protection law, it may be very hard to enforce the German law against the providers. And this does also lead to some, well, I wouldn't say strange developments, but at least developments where one could ask oneself, is this okay, is this right? Supervisory authorities tend to approach the provider as long as possible, but once the provider, cloud provider here for instance, once the provider is situated outside of Germany or outside of the EU, they approach the service provider that used the cloud provider. So with respect to Facebook, for instance, in Schleswig-Holstein, I said it in the beginning, it was not Facebook who was approached, and it was not Facebook where the supervisory authority said you have to comply with German law. It was the website providers that used the Facebook social plugins. They were approached and they were told you should not use the social plugin anymore. Simply because they had their seat in Germany, they had their seat in Schleswig-Holstein, and they were easier to get. And this is what you have to keep in mind as well, simply from a factual point of view. The moment you have your seat in Germany, it's more likely that you will be approached than that your cloud provider, which is situated outside of Germany or outside of the EU, will be approached.
But from a technical perspective, the website owners integrated the Facebook bubble, so they were giving the personal data to the cloud provider, so I think it's okay if they were approached.
Yes. Sorry. Yeah. The question was the website providers included their website plugins, and so they forwarded the data to Facebook from a technical point of view, and that was conclusion was that's why it is okay that these providers were approached. To some extent, yes, of course, from a technical point of view, the website providers were forwarding the data, or at least they instructed the user's browser to forward the data. But still, it's Facebook where the most efforts would be in order to change the process in order to make it compliant. So from a legal point of view, it might make sense to Facebook and say, okay, Facebook, you have to deal with this, you have to be more transparent, or you have to change certain things. But of course, that's why the website provider was responsible, because they initiated the transfer of the data to Facebook.
I do not quite understand the borderline. The Facebook button is a combination of an image and some JavaScript.
Mm-hmm.
And that's apparently problematic. So what about a website that, say, is mine, and I am including just an image from, say, Facebook? Is that problematic?
This is problematic, and this is, in fact, the issue that's currently being discussed. Simply because of one fact: from the visitor's point of view, you have your website. The visitor opens your website, and the visitor doesn't see and recognize that there is...
So I can't include a foreign image on my website?
It depends on what is done with this foreign image.
Well, I wouldn't know.
That's exactly the fact. If you drag it down to this, and you want to be 100% sure, yes, then you can't include foreign images.
The next question then, so what if it's not the image, but the actual HTML of my page that is hosted in a foreign land? Say I have a blog on, say, blogspot.com, or I have a Facebook page mm-hmm. instead of a blog that is running in Germany. Am I actually allowed to offer my services from foreign services, a service to Germans?
That's actually... In fact, the question which has been discussed from in the North German supervisory authorities, from a technical point of view, what they criticized, I mean, we all, I think, of the opinion that including of third-party content as such is not evil. So from a technical point of view, you might even be forced to do so with respect to load capacity issues and so forth, with respect to cross-site issues. What the supervisory authority criticized is that you have the possibility to collect certain data, and that this collection is not transparent. You open your website, and in that moment, Facebook gets the information, which IP address did open the website. You get all the normal information you get when accessing the website, including the referrer, browser version, and so on. And if this data is used to set up user profiles, and that was what the supervisory authority said Facebook would do, they connected with the user profiles, they connected with login names, then it's evil.
But isn't that completely utter nonsense from a practical point of view? I mean, this is dropping Germany off the internet, if you think that through to the end.
Yes. I wouldn't say it's completely nonsense, but it's done, well, 99% of all the websites use social plugins or use Google Analytics, which has been the same issue from a data protection point of view. It's currently used that way, and that's how the web works, but data protection authorities say that currently as it is done, it's... Yep.
But Google Analytics is now legal. The only thing that has been changed, really, is that everybody who is using Google Analytics in Germany has sent 12 pages of paper to Google in Hamburg. And that's about zero change technically. It is just print 12 pages, sign, and you're done.
Yes.
So nothing has been actually factually done for data protection. It's just hand waving.
I completely agree. Google Analytics was the same issue, where you, at the end, had an agreement with the data protection authorities. Now you set up an agreement on commission data processing. From a legal point of view, that's what we call it, these 12 pages of paper, where Google is the data processor and you are the controller. From a technical point of view, it doesn't make any sense. From a legal, neither, because Google is not just the processor, because Google intends to do certain things with this data as well. Google, of course, does not collect the data for you and does not provide free web hosting or free server statistic services, but they want to do something with the data as well. But that's what was agreed with the data protection authorities. And this is how data protection works in Germany. It's not very easy, but you have a very strong authorities. You have to deal with it somehow. And in the end, you might come up with a compromise, which from a legal and technical point of view might seem a bit odd, but it's somehow a compromise. And I know that what you said reflects what 99% of the users or of the websites are currently doing. I know of one court procedure which is currently pending in order to clarify this issue, but I don't know the actual status of this court procedure. So we, of course, do expect and would highly appreciate if we would have some case law on this, and if we would have some neutral instance saying that's not a compromise, but that's what you can demand from a legal point of view. But we're not up to that point yet. So sorry for not being more clear on that point, but I think we'll either have to wait or take the risk, which can be minimized with respect to some modifications. I'm running a bit out of time, so I would suggest that I continue now with the slides, and perhaps you also might continue our discussion in the coffee break. And perhaps some of the questions may be already answered within the next few slides. So what do the German supervisory authorities demand with respect to cloud computing? In 2011, in September, a guidance has been drafted and issued from the supervisory authorities, which highlights the requirements that these authorities expect from cloud providers. So three main issues, or some of these issues, already are stipulated by applicable law anyway. It has to be clear that the cloud user can correct, delete, or block data. So the moment the cloud user says data has to be deleted, it has to be deleted, and there is no, well, I still have backups, or sorry, from a technical point of view, I only can delete on Tuesdays, or whatever. Deletion means deletion. In fact, it is not always that way. You only have limited access and limited possibilities to control your data. So this is why the authority said we have to have an agreement on a contractual penalty with a provider, which is part of applicable law currently anyway, but it's just to highlight that it's very important with respect to cloud computing, according to the supervisory authorities. We have to arrange for respective rights for sub-providers. So it's not enough that we have an agreement with the cloud provider, but we have to ensure that the sub-providers of the cloud provider are bound by this agreement as well. And this, of course, is difficult in practice from an organizational point of view. There are lots of sub-providers that you don't know, and these sub-providers may be in a different position and may not agree to all the clauses you want to agree on with the cloud provider. Transfer of data is one big question. How can you get the data from A to B? How can you get the data, especially from countries to non-European countries? First of all, one big issue is still not resolved. If you process data within a group of companies, you don't have any special clauses on transfer of data between these group members, which means every single legal entity has to be dealt as a complete foreign entity. So if you and your group from the services AG transfer data to the hosting services GmbH or to the consulting GmbH, it has to be dealt as a third-party data transfer. Even though it's within the same group, you have to find a justification for that. And there, the solution of commissioned data processing mainly is, well, the way to go. Because apart from commissioned data processing, if you rely on the other justifications we had in the beginning, it will become very difficult. So Every time you hear commission data processing, that's the solution in order to transfer data from A to B. However, this commission data processing has to comply with certain legal requirements. And once you don't comply with these requirements, you don't have a justification from a data protection point of view. And well, this is from a legal point of view a big problem. So that's the transfer from the cloud user to the cloud controller. You're the user here and you want to involve your cloud provider, and this transfer may be either this transfer due to one of the standard justification clauses, 28, or section 28 of the Federal Data Protection Act, or it can be commissioned data processing. If you take aside the data processing part and if you just have the section 28, then it either has to be necessary for this contractual relationship, I already said it in the beginning, between data subject and controller. So controller and data subject. But once your customer is not data subject, once your customer collects data of other data subjects, so you would have a fourth party here, you would need an agreement between the cloud user and this fourth party. In general, you don't have it, so it doesn't help. Then you have the legitimate interests, overweighing interests, as I said, very vague. So you should go for data process, commission data processing. Requirements are an agreement in writing, which complies with all the other agreements, we'll come to that soon, contained in section 11. And if this is given, then the processor here is regarded as, we say in German, controller's right hand, meaning it's part of the legal entity from a data protection point of view, it's regarded as one. You don't have, you don't even speak of a transfer from a legal point of view, it's just, well, commission data processing. One big and important requirement, this data processing does also have to be lived as a data processing agreement. So if you sign the 12 pages from Google, Google has to follow your instructions. Google has to do with the data what you want, you Google want to do. And I have my doubts if in this example it is the case. If you as Mr. Unknown, Mr. Very Unimportant, will say, okay, Google, now please do this and do that with the data. So this is one thing that has to be regarded. In fact, it has to be commission data processing. Supervisory authorities set up some requirements where they say commission data processing is given or is not given. Here, the processor does not must not have any decision-making power. Once processor decides on what to do with the data, it's no commission data processing. Controller has to be responsible with respect to third parties. If the processor is responsible, again, no commission data processing. And there shouldn't be any legal relationship between the processor and the data subjects. So coming back to the first slide, between the processor and the data subjects, once you have a direct agreement here, it's a strong indication that it is no commission data processing. Some more issues on when commission data processing is not given, I won't go into detail here, you will have it in the slides, just in order to get an impression how this data processing, commission data processing has to be lived like, how it has to be implemented, and in these cases you don't, or you have a strong indication against commission data processing. This is what has to be in the contract. This is absolutely mandatory. It's stipulated in section 11 of the Federal Data Protection Act, so subject and duration of the contract. Very big issue, extent, nature and purpose of data processing. So if you just take a draft, if you take a template of this section 11 agreement, you have to fill out these blanks. You have to say, what kind of data am I processing? What am I doing with the data? This is some work which always has to be done. And next issue is also very important, technical and organizational security measures. There you have to fill out the blanks as well. You have to describe what you do as the processor with respect to data security in your company. This work once done is done. That's okay, but you have to do it once, and then you have a certain set of terms and conditions that you also that you always add to this commissioned agreement on commissioned data processing. You may have gotten into touch with that because this is what usually ends up at the IT experts, where we legal say, okay, we don't know, some encryption, whatever, simply describe what you're doing with respect to password length, with respect to technical security, locks at the computers, surveillance facilities of the data center. But once you fill it out and once you don't change your standards, the work is done. You have to implement a process for correction, delete, and blocking of data. Already said that. You have to implement controls, meaning rights to audit the processor. And you have to say something about subcontracting, if you want to allow it and to what extent you want to allow it. One issue, one more issue with respect to cross-border data transfer. One of the main principles of cloud computing is that you don't have a localized computer network, or that you are not bound to certain hardware servers, but that, of course, you all know it, I won't tell you anything new, that you are able to shift between computers with respect to loads and specific current requirements, which means users do not know whether data is currently being processed. The bigger the company, the more, well, facilities they have all around the world. From a data protection point of view, the provider has to inform the user of these sites. It's also some work, and the bigger you are, often you need to update this list, but once done, you should have it. But still, this is one issue that is very often forgotten. So, back to some cross-border questions. excuse me. Within the EU, if you have cross-border data transfer, you're not subject to any special requirements, as within the EU, one certain standard does apply. The provider, as a data processor, is not a third party. I said it, once you're a data processor, you're regarded as part of your legal entity. And, well, actually, no big issues. So if you want to ensure this, we strongly recommend to put in a contractual obligation into the agreement stating that data may only be processed in the European Union, because this simplifies issues quite a lot. If you can't do so, if you don't want to do so, so if you have data transferred to non-EU countries, then you have to regard certain additional measures you have to apply in order to make the data transfer compliant. So here in this example, we have the cloud provider, and we have, well, a group member of the cloud provider, or we have a third party. But in any case, the data processing takes place outside of the EU. The European Commission says, within the EU, everything's fine. From a factual point of view, this can be doubted, but the assumption is, in the European Union, we have an adequate standard of data protection. Outside of the EU, everything's evil, because only very few countries have a comparable standard of data protection, which means if you're not transferring the data to one of these countries, you need to put in force additional safeguards. So apart from the general question, am I allowed to transfer data to a third party, where commissioned data processing may help, you still have to ensure that even if you're, from data protection law point of view, allowed to transfer the data, you have to ensure that you have an adequate standard in the target country of this data processing. So here in the US, you have to set up additional safeguards. What can you do in order to achieve and ensure that you have the same standard? Once more, you can obtain the consent of the data subject. So you can ask every single data subject, are you okay if I process your data in the United States? Every single data subject, which makes it very difficult to implement, And again, it's revocable, this consent. So once one data subject says no, you have to set up a backup data center and, well, process the data in this backup data center in the European Union. In the USA, you can work with the Safe Harbor certification. So if the data processor with seat in the United States is certified under the Safe Harbor rules, then that's okay. You can implement corporate binding rules. This makes sense than big companies. So if you as a large company say, okay, I want to ensure that I'm able to transfer the data from all the group members to all the other group members, then you set up kind of privacy policy, a company-wide privacy policy, which is a lot of work, and you also need an agreement, need a confirmation by the supervisory authorities. Best solution, in fact, is standard contractual clauses. So the EU has issued model contracts. These model contracts allow the data to be processed in non-EU member states. One requirement, you must not change a single word of these model contracts. You can change titles, you can change the numbering, but once you go into the details of the contract, you're in danger to lose the protection by this agreement. So once you're negotiating contract with a cloud provider, you should say, okay, here are the model contracts. If they have dealt with it, they know what you're talking about. If not, you simply have to say, that's absolutely a deal breaker. This contract has to be agreed as it is. No negotiations. So one of these measures has to be taken. If you don't take these measures, the processing of data is not permitted to non-EU countries. As time goes by, I would say we cut this slide. There are lots of risks, very high fines, compensations of the affected. So if you're in breach of data protection law, it may become a bigger problem. Biggest issue is here bad press and damage of reputation, because once you can read your latest data security breaches on Heise.de, on Golem, on whatever big news site, you have a problem. Software licenses, I want to cut this short. it's one issue you have to think about with respect to cloud computing. Main question is, if you as a cloud provider provide software to cloud users, or the other way around, if you as a cloud user use software provided by the cloud provider, you have to somehow clarify what's happening with the software. Who is using the software, who needs usage rights, and who may just be, well, accessing a user interface and not using the software as such. The copyright law in Germany says that the execution of software requires a consent for its reproduction, as the execution means loading into the memory, and loading into the memory means duplication. From a technical point of view, it's copied from the hard drive into the memory. And this leads to the question, who makes the copy in a cloud computing context? We have some case law. Here we have a decision of the Federal Supreme Court in 2009, who said with respect to recording certain televisions, who is making the reproduction? The question has to be answered from a technical point of view. You have to simply take a look at the physical processes that take place. Here the court said, manufacturer of reproductions is the one who technically takes care of the physical definition. It's not yet clear how this can be, if it at all can be applied to cloud computing, and how it could be applied. But one risk is that it's the user who makes the copy. So if you use software within a cloud computing context, again, depending on, of course, specific specialities of the case, but if you as the user use or make the copy, then you need to have a certain sufficient licenses. So the provider must have the rights, of course. If he provides software to you, you should ensure that the provider has the rights to provide the software. And if it is from a technical perspective that way that you do the copy, that you make a copy, then you do have you need to have respective usage rights yourself. If you're in doubt, you should clarify it with your provider, and you should clarify it with the software provider. One more issue with respect to open source software. Open source software under the GPL. One question is, do you have a duplication? Do you have a, or from the other way around, if does the viral effect, the copyleft effect, apply to software which is provided in a cloud computing context? For instance, Google Docs. You do know the solution, I presume. It's simply a browser-based solution, which is working from your browser. So the software as such is hosted on Google servers, and you just more or less get the graphical user interface transferred to your computer. But the computing and the software as such is run on the Google computers. And there we have the question: does the viral effect of the GPL apply? Does Google have to publish the source code? As it is currently, I would say the viral effect does not apply. So you're not obliged to provide the source code, which means you can take software, you can still provide the software to the public in a certain manner, but you're not required to provide the source code, which is somehow, you can, well, you may say it's a circumvention of the GPL, because you provide software, you can use software, but you can't get the source code. On the other hand, it's clearly stipulated that way. So in the, at least in the GPL v3, in the current version, it's said in the definitions part that mere interaction with the user through a computer network is not conveying with respect to conveying a copy of the software. And then as a consequence, if you do not convey the software, the copyleft effect does not apply. We don't know how courts would see it, so currently there's no case law on this. But certain companies, of course, use this uncertainty in order to avoid the publications of sources. Best practices, I want to cut that short. Main issue is you need to have a guarantee that you will have the necessary rights to use the software if you're a cloud user. You should ensure that you as a cloud user may use the software and that your cloud provider has sufficient rights. And perhaps you should even agree on an indemnification in order to ensure that if third parties will approach you, that you can say, okay, cloud provider, you are responsible for that, you have to indemnify me. Well, some words on liability. We had this question in the beginning. Who is liable, and when do we, or how do we have, how can we come to issues where the company such is liable? This is what is defined in the German Civil Code. A person acts negligently if he fails to exercise reasonable care. In that case, you have a Sorgfaltspflichtverletzung from a legal point of view. How can these breaches of this liability, how can this liability arise? You may have production delays, compensation for delay once your IT is not working properly. You may have breach of confidentiality agreements. So if, for instance, your cloud solution is not secure with respect to data privacy, you may be liable. Even if you don't deal with a contractual partner, you may be liable to third parties. Data is compromised, so you have a property infringement or may have a property infringement. These are more or less just some highlights where liability can arise. One big issue that I just want to quickly highlight is that you should think about a security policy. security policy and with respect to cloud computing is an essential part of what you do when dealing with cloud computing, because if this, such a policy is missing, German KR says this is already a breach of KR. Simply to say, well, we use cloud computing, but we don't have any idea on what we do from a technical point of view. This is rather risky, and we have case law on this here for instance, the Cologne District Court, that in that case, the breach or a missing policy can lead to severe consequences. I think the time is already over. Some very short remarks. Exit management, you have it in the slides. Take a look at them, because there are many mistakes can be made. Always keep in mind that at one point in time, you may need or want to exit the cloud. And then you need to have some language agreement in order to ensure a proper exit management. Otherwise, you're simply stuck in your solution. You don't get the data out. You don't get your provider, your old provider, to help you leaving the cloud, which can lead to very high costs and make the change to another provider impossible at all. So that was a quick overview on some legal aspects that you might come along with cloud computing. I'm happy to answer any questions now or on the coffee break. I hope it was not too exhaustive. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Are there any questions for now, or do you stick to the coffee break? Yeah, there's one.
More remarks. First thing, while this is a data center conference, one should not forget that the data protection laws also apply to private people. So if you're a private person and give away data of other persons, you're also liable. And the second one is, if we talk about companies and the internet and data protection, it's always the web that's in front of all the headlines. But one should not forget that also emails have the same procedure and the same problems. So if you are hosting your email services outside of Europe, you might get in troubles too.
Sure. One thing, this does not only apply to web services, of course. So email data, employee data is a very crucial issue. So if you intend to outsource your account management, if you intend to outsource your employee data, you have to take a very close look at what you're doing. With respect to private persons, the data protection law is a bit less stressful. Because if you simply process it in a pure private context, then generally you're not subject to data protection laws. But still, of course, you can have a liability. For instance, if you are an employee at a firm, then this may lead to certain obligations. And of course, you should not take the data home and say, well, now I'm a private person, I can spam as much as I want. This will lead to severe consequences, that's for sure.
Thank you.